Excellent. Well, thank you everyone for coming. So I'm Ray Potter, CEO of SafeLogic, and with me is Whit Diffie, technical advisor to SafeLogic, and I guess he really needs no introduction. So, no, I'm glad you all are here, and pardon the informality of the talk today, but we just wanted to have a kind of a conversation about some things that, you know, are near and dear to our hearts at SafeLogic in terms of crypto and some things that we're working on in the constrained device and Internet of Things space. I just wanted to share with you some of the challenges and some of the successes that we've seen there. So, so basically getting into crypto for constrained devices, one thing that kind of kicked all this off relatively recently that Whit mentioned yesterday at the crypto panel was NSA's release of Simon and Speck algorithms that were specifically designed for those types of constrained environments, right? And I know Whit's got a massive background on those particular algorithms, which I'd like you to share in a second. But we kind of, as those were released, the timing was kind of interesting, right? And I think almost regardless of how good or bad the algorithms were, considering the source and at the point that they were released, I think generally there was some conspiracy theories out there about, you know, what are in these algorithms, what don't we know about, what's, you know, is there sufficient, you know, external cryptanalysis, et cetera. And you know, what were your thoughts with that?
Well, I never much suspected them of that. Let me digress a moment to how I believe those algorithms came about, because in June of 2011, I and a number of colleagues gave a briefing at NSA on an algorithm called Hummingbird, which charming object, looks more like a rotor machine than anything else, but if you imagine a rotor machine with an internal change of state function that's rather like skipjack or DES, and with certain very, very valuable synchronization properties and intermixing authentication with encryption properties. Well, I belonged to a company called Revere Security that was hawking this algorithm, and we briefed NSA, and I had been told, and this is not a violation of what I was told because the circumstances are a little different, but I was told if IAD agreed to evaluate the algorithm for a military customer, then they wouldn't come back with a report that says, you know, well, you know, you really ought to use this out of our own inventory. And couldn't have done anything about it anyway. You know, you're trying to sell to a giant dragon. You do what the dragon wants. So they asked for a briefing, and we gave them a briefing on Hummingbird. And in short, they found our presentation on why an algorithm of this sort was needed persuasive. But people told me that they thought of the algorithm, and I think this is not unreasonable, that being it was sufficiently far from what had become the mainstream of design, that evaluating it would be rather complex. And I had to admit that, because just explaining it to people who were used to the usual framework was difficult. So even they designed against us and produced two, to my mind, charming algorithms. Though, disclosure, I'm not as versed in the literature of the lightweight algorithms as I might be. That turns out there are lots of others with some similar characteristic. Lots of rounds, and each round is not very expensive. At any event, Simon uses cellular automata as combining functions. That is, at least on the face of it, much cheaper than a table lookup. You have three inputs or so tapped, three or four or five inputs in each round tapped and fed back. And Speck, I thought, was an attractive design because Speck uses an adder, a modulo n adder, as its nonlinear function, which is sort of partway to an algorithm called like RC6, which was one of the candidates that wasn't selected for the advanced encryption standard, which uses the 32-bit multiplier on the theory that that's readily available. But the adder, you know, a 32-bit multiplier design is a little bit inflexible in the sense if you wouldn't want to build that from scratch out of gates, because 32-bit multiplier is a big complicated thing to build. So this is in between. It uses an n-bit adder, and that can be built cheap as a ripple carry adder or many more gates. When I say expensive, I mean many more gates as a carry look-ahead adder. And so that spec design is something that could be adapted rather reasonably to either hardware or software, though they presented it sort of as the more software-friendly one of the two.
That's right. And I think we'll come back to more discussion of Simon and Spec and what we did with it in a little bit later in the talk. But you know, and even with all that, it's something that we couldn't really ignore, basically because with the growth of mobile, we see the same thing happening on the constrained device side, right? Everyone's talking about Internet of Things, and while it's not really there yet, it's getting there. So it's something that we wanted to pay attention to. A couple of use cases, right? So when we look at constrained devices, we're talking about a couple of different things, one of which is wearables, right? So whether it's a Google Glass unit or a Samsung Gear Watch, there will absolutely be the need for some sort of strong cryptography on these devices. A particular use case for Google Glass, for example, is if a surgeon is recording a procedure. Well, all of a sudden now they've got patient data sitting on the device, which needs to be encrypted per HIPAA rules. And I don't think a lot of people have really thought about that yet. It's especially with Glass, people are trying to find that first killer app, right? But as apps start to proliferate, I think there's going to be the need for some strong crypto, which is really what we wanted to address. And then as we look at other constrained devices, and I know Whit's got a ton of background on this side too, but you start to look at things that people don't normally think about in terms of security and cryptography. A Nest is a great example, right? Connected to the internet, there's all sorts of interesting hacks that could happen. You can break into a Nest and see if it's in away mode to see if someone's at home or if they're on vacation, right? Another example we were talking about just before the session is in the dead of winter in Chicago, it'd be a shame if someone went through and cut off access and basically froze you. So I mean, there's some real threats out there that I don't think people are necessarily thinking about yet until something happens. And it's the same thing on the industrial side too, right?
Yeah. The kind of things we considered, and we were front and center with RFID, because RFID tags very frequently have a very low power budget. But in some other kinds of cases, if you think about something like a wireless sensor network, then security in a wireless sensor network may be very important. And yet, particularly, if you put it, there are many kinds of hard-to-get-at places you put one. So one example is in medical devices. Put it inside the body. You don't want to do an operation to change the battery any more often than you need to. And another, of course, is sprinkling them into some kind of a denied area, more a military application. But you don't want to go back and service them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, as we start to explore a little bit more, I want to share with you some of the challenges that we face. So, as a company, what we do is develop cryptographic modules for specifically rooted in mobile, but also for server environments and also for wearables, right? And we do it with a sense of drop-in compliance for different regulated environments, whether it's federal for FIPS 140 or what have you. So I wanted to kind of share some of the challenges that we saw in trying to develop what we did for constrained devices. One of them was space constraints, right? So depending on the environment, you're not going to have a whole lot of space. I mean, a phone has much more memory than either the Gear Watch or Google Glass or certainly some of the embedded Internet of Things devices or smart meters or what have you. So, space and footprint become paramount when trying to design a crypto module. One of the reasons we were looking at Simon and Spec was exactly for that particular case. But I'm going to come back to that in a second.
Yeah, well, they focused on gate count. In mm-hmm. my background, we focused on something a little different, which is power consumption. Mm-hmm. But both of them, they're sort of related, mm-hmm. and both of them are important.
Right. And, well, that was the interesting thing about power is actually the processor is much more powerful than we actually thought. So as we were going through and running some performance tests, we built a proof of concept using Simon and Spec, also built a proof of concept doing AES 128, ran a couple of maybe rudimentary performance tests, but essentially bulk encrypting 50, 100 megs of data, and found that the performance between the two was somewhat negligible. I mean, and
that's the performance difference.
Right, the performance difference. That's right. So, but that kind of ties to what Whit had mentioned yesterday on the crypto panel was, if I understood correctly, is kind of planning for the future, right? And thinking about using AES 128 or 256, even if it's not, you know, required right now. Did I catch that right?
No, I think what I said yesterday, and in light of your performance test, which I didn't know at that time, maybe it's less significant than I thought, but what I said was that since Simon and Spec are flexible in their parameters, so the papers give sizes all the way from blocks down around in the 20s or something up to 128 like AES, and I just said, well, if you run it in the AES range and it's faster, and assuming it turns out to be just as secure, then, you know, maybe you would want to switch. Sounds like maybe it isn't faster, though I'm still confident it has to have a lower gate count because you don't have to have 2,000 bits for that lookup table. Mm-hmm. And the ways you make AES really fast are it parallelizes very nicely in a couple of directions, mm-hmm. but you end up approximately linearly multiplying the number of lookup tables in return proportional to the speed gain. So.
Yeah, and I guess the final challenge that we saw was kind of rooted in validation, right? So, you know, as I said, when we look at crypto, we kind of focus on standards-based crypto and for, you know, specific regulated environments. So we're very fond of things like FIPS 140 because that's what our customers ask for. Even within the healthcare space, that's what people are, you know, tend to favor, if not necessarily require. So as we were looking at Simon and Spec, it kind of also hit us. It said, okay, well, what do we do with this, right? We can't actually put this through FIPS validation. So if there in the future is a, you know, customer of ours that's trying to sell into federal or trying to sell into, you know, what have you, we can't necessarily give them that check mark. So, you know, we combined all of those things together and kind of realized that using standards-based crypto like AES, even in constrained environments, actually works. And, you know, I think potentially offsets any minimal gain in performance that Simon and Spec would have given us.
Well, I think for the moment, being standards-based has proven so important in crypto, mm-hmm. because if you know, all of these advantages, whether you're thinking about a network and everybody being able to communicate with everybody else, or you're thinking about modular design and just wanting to go out and pick up a part that's the same part everybody else uses. Mm-hmm. Now, I think it's very interesting to look at new designs, and I think the fact that one came from NSA, which potentially can get it included in the NIST list of approved standards, mm-hmm. Much more readily than a commercial producer could, or at least that was my experience when I was hawking one, that is interesting to consider. But for the moment, we have AES, and the problem is far more one of implementation than of algorithm. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we focus on, is implementations that can readily be certified and approved as FIPS 140 compliant, mm-hmm. in any place you put them, right. And minimizing the cost of that. So constrained environment is in your wallet.
I loved that yesterday, by the way. I thought that was fantastic. I think it's right on. So time for a little like doom and gloom and fun. So what, like, what's the worst case, right? If we're looking at Internet of Things, if we're looking at constrained devices, if we're looking at utilities, if we're looking at wearables, you know, I can think of a few, right? But what do you see as kind of some worst case scenarios? One that jumps to my mind is potentially hacking things like pacemakers or, you know, the medical devices that people might be wearing on them, where you could, you know, basically, you know, worst case, kill someone, right? I mean, there's all sorts of doom and gloom stories.
Well,
but which ones
I'm
do
told
you think
the
about?
Secret Service worried about that for Cheney, mm-hmm. right? His detractors thought there was no danger of somebody sabotaging the pacemaker of his heart. He had no heart. That was just a cover story. But a man named Kevin Fu, who was just moved from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst to University of Michigan at Ann Arbor, has been working on security of embedded operating systems to run your organs. And we worked with him some on low power consumption crypto for that environment. There have been a bunch of people with, you know, combination of ability and sense of humor who've done things like communicate with people's brakes and with their tire pressure sensors and things like that while they were driving by. So, you know, the bottom line is wirelessness is so much an advantage, even when everything's all close together, the way it is in a car or a truck, that that opens up a vulnerability. I mean, if we had really good wirelessness, we could take this guy who's walking out, and we could keep this playing in his ear, and he couldn't get away from it.
That's right.
But so I think we're going to have to contend in the past. Right? There have been a whole lot of security environments in which different security aspects build on each other. Because there are locked doors, then, you know, yes, you need other policies within and so forth, but that limits. So, I mean, for the perfect example is security standards for safes interact with the guards' rounds because the times, you know, you want to have the guard come by more often than one could get into the safe, and it limits the amount, weight of tools you can bring in, things like that. Crypto applies to all the environments, and, of course, it started out in modern days with radio in the First World War. Crypto applies to the environments typically where there aren't ancillary security measures that can be applied. And you might think in something like a car, well, we will deal with this because we'll wire, you know, we'll wire everything together. But after all, you probably even do things other than the wheels, but the wheels are spinning. It's a nuisance to run a wire to the wheels. I mean, you have to commutator in the axle and complicate a place that's already prone to failure and critical and so forth. So I think we're going to see, you know, people's livers communicating with their kidneys by wireless, and people's brakes communicating with their steering wheels by wireless, and all of that sort of thing. So I think wireless is a funny repeat of history, that crypto became real in World War I when it was the only security measure that could protect radio, and now we're doing it again by bringing radio back into everything.
And I guess that's my biggest fear, is that not too many people are thinking about it or planning for it. And, you know, I think my biggest fear is that something's going to happen, whether it's in a car or a pacemaker or what have you, before people start to pay attention to it. So, I don't know, hopefully we can do a little bit of awareness and get people thinking about this, you know, security and crypto in constrained devices from the get-go. So. Excellent. Well, I think we're about out of time. I know it was a very quick session today, but we're going to head over to the show at the South Hall at 1809, App Authorities booth. We're going to do a little, just kind of some Q&A, right? So if anyone wants to stop by and take pictures of me, I don't know if you want to take pictures of Whit, but, you know.
Now, they got an old file photo to go on.
That's right. I might photobomb if someone's taking some pictures with Whit. But no, so we'd love to have you over at App Authorities booth, and we'll just kind of sit and talk a little bit more and answer any questions you have or anything like that. So thank you all very much.